So today we'll be discussing about business rules, task lists, menus, and we will be discussing on workflow. That will complete your planning application. So till now we have discussed how to create your metadata and how to create your web forms, how to attach a calculation script or a business rule to your web form. We have seen how to attach a smart list, and we have also seen how to convert your currencies from your local currencies to reporting currencies. And apart from that, we have seen different types of web forms at it. Okay, and we have seen how you'll be copying your supporting details from one cell to other cell. And we have also seen how to clear your data from one cell to how to clear your data in cells. Right? Okay. Now, today let us discuss about your business rules. So from your planning application interface or from your planning web-based URL login, you'll not be able to create your business rules. So if you see here, all available business rules are there. And at the same time, what you can do, you can just launch them, you can run them. Means a business rule can be launched from here, from your tools and business rules option, or else you can also run your business rule from your web forms. So if I open this particular form, I can launch my business rule from here on. Two areas from a web-based URL I can launch. One is from tools, and another one is when they are attached to your web form, you can launch your business rules, right? But where to create that particular business rules? Business rules are created in your SBase. Means your SBase administration services, they are created. They are not created into SBase server. They are not created on your SBase server. They are created with your SBase administration server. SBase administration server, where they are created, there is a heading called as business rules heading. Under this, there is something called as a repository view. Under this repository view, you have something called as rules. Under this rules, there are some pre-existing rules which we have created already. So now if you want to create your rules, write it on this and you can say new rule. This will create your business rule. So means business rules can only be created on your administration server. They cannot be created in your planning application. So where are your business rules created? Your business rules are created with your SBase administration server. They are not created in your SBase server, but they are created in your SBase administration server. In that, under a heading called as business rule, under business rules, a heading called as a repository view, under repository view, under a heading called as a rules, your business rules will be created. The first topic that they say or they ask on your business rules is, what is the difference between your business rules and calculation scripts? Okay? Business rules and calculation scripts, from a performance point of view, they are one and the same. If this will calculate, they will also calculate. Calculation scripts are used for calculations. Business rules are also used for your calculations purpose only. But the major difference that you see between your business rules and calculation scripts is, calculation scripts are code driven. You have to write your code. Whereas your business rule is a graphical user interface. Means you need not write any code. Automatically your code will be generated. And apart from that, your calculation scripts cannot have runtime prompts. Whereas your business rules can have runtime prompts. So what are these runtime prompts? What is this graphical user interface that we have with your business? For that, let us right click on your rules and say new rule. When I say new rule, if you see, it is opening a web page, it is opening a page wherein okay. So it will open a page wherein you will be able to see your graphical source tab. Means whatever you want to interpret, you have to interpret in graphical mode. That will be in turn interpreted into your source code. Meer graphical ga rasedanni at the back end, your machine itself it will write it into code form. Or else you can directly write your code also. Dintlo meer directly you can type your code, calculation script code, set commands, fix commands, if command, data copy command. You can all write your codes manually, or you can go with this graphical representation. So from where I'll get this particular graphical tools? For that, select your BR language. When you select BR language, you'll be able to see all your graphical options in this. All your graphical options are available in this particular business. So now what I want to do is I want to copy my data from this particular web form. Say I'm having some data on my account 01 for January, and for member called as local, and for a entity called as India, and in a budget, and in a BUI version, and for year FY21. I have some data called as 100 in this cell. I'll say save. So now my requirement is this 100 should be copied to this particular account 02. So what I want to do? I want to do clearly a data copy. So how I can do that? So I'll select this icon and I'll drag and drop it onto this particular. Sorry, before that, what I should be doing? Let me delete it. Before this, I have to set this business rule to a particular application where this particular business rule has to be used. So I have to select my outline. They can be used in your business sometimes, okay, but mostly they are meant for your planning applications only. No, if you are interactive user, or if you are a administrator, or if you are a database manager, or if you are a provisional manager, from your interactive user above all whatever roles you have, all the users can create this business. Okay, so now I want to select my outline. To which outline I have to write this particular business rule? I'll select my outline by double clicking. Okay, so because I want this to be available in my planning applications, but this will throw an error. When I expand this, it throws an error because I have some issue. I need to rectify this. So instead of that, what I'll do is I'll write this business rule into my SBS server. Actually, they have to be dependent on your planning, but I'm writing it on my SBS server because even my SBS will have my planning application. So in this, I'm going to put this particular business rule on my Asia Express. Instead of selecting a planning application, I've selected planning SBS application because I'm having an issue in that. Some software related issue, then I have to rectify it. Okay, now I have selected my outline on which this particular business rule has to act. Now I'll say copy my data. So from where you want to copy this data? So select source, destination. When I select this source, if I drag this up, if you see HSP rates, accounts, periods, years, scenario, version, and your currency. What all dimensions you have in your planning application, all dimensions are displayed here. So from HSP rates, where is your value inputted? Whenever you are inputting data on local, it means that your data is getting inputted onto a member called as, when I click on this, a member called as HSP underscore input values. If you are inputting something on local, means where it is getting locked and sent, it is getting with a combination called as HSP underscore input values. So I'll select this. So from which account you want to copy this? I want to copy from account 01. From here I want to copy it. I'll say okay. And from which period? From January period. Right? From my graphical interface, the data is present on my January. Okay? And from which year? FY21. So according to my selections, if you go to your source, your calculation script is getting defined. Same thing we'll be writing in your calculation script, right? The same thing is getting defined into your source code. So meanwhile, let me complete this scenario. Scenario is budget. Okay. Version is BUI version. I can directly type it, or I can select it from this selection tool. It's a copy. And currency, from where it is getting copied? From local currency. And for which entity? For India entity, I want to copy this. Okay. Now I have completed my source. Now I have to define my destination. Select your destination. So from destination, where it has to be updated? It has to be updated into your HSP underscore input values only. But from account, where it has to be updated? It has to be updated into account 03. This is the only difference that we are going to see. And from period, it has to be updated onto your February. These are the two differences that we need, right? Just we are doing all your selections. Say from here, it is FY12 only. There is no change in it. Scenario, budget. Version, UI version. If you want different version, you can select that version, different version. From currency, it has to be copied onto your local currency only. So if I go to my source now, now if you see, I have selected, right, India. Okay, even destination, it should be India. Okay, let us make it as India. Okay, so now if I go to my source, what it did, it has written your calculation script saying that it has fixed on UI version, local version, on local currency, budget, India, HSP input value for your FY12, and the data that is present on your account 01 of January should be copied to account 03 of February. But this graphical thing, every time if you want to write this type of thing, if you want to do these selections, instead of doing that, you can happily type your code. So most of the times, though it is a graphical driven tool, Business Rules is a graphical driven tool, and most of the developers, they prefer using source only. Instead of writing this many fix, what I'll do, I'll put a comma. When I try to edit something, it says we want to change it to an enhanced calculation script mode. This change is not undoable and all your graphical components will be removed. Means if I say yes, this particular graphical thing will be lost. If I say yes, this tab will get blurred. So now I can happily do my things. So let me make it as. So I'm remaining the remaining. So this is how I have written my business rule. So if it is a calculation script, if you write this much, it is more than enough. But this is a business rule. There are extra things that you need to set. You need not define variables. They are not mandate. You need not go into usages. You need not go into docs and you need not go into properties, but you have to go into locations. So this particular business rule, where it should be available? It should be available in your location, this location, mostly in your planning location. But this, if I set this, it will be available only with your SBase application. But where I want this, I want to see this in my planning application also. So for that, what I'm doing, I'm saying allow all locations. Display this particular business rule in all planning applications, all SBase applications. And Apart from this, you have to compulsorily define who user should be capable of running this particular business. If no user is having access on this, what happens? This particular business rule always will throw an error. So for this, I'm adding user called as admin and admin employee. I'll say okay. These two users are having, because I am an administrator, my name is admin. I want to run this particular business rule. Even though you are having interactive user, you cannot run this business rule until and unless if you don't have access on this. Whereas on your calculation script, you have to define it in your shared services. Whereas this business rule, it is defined here only. Okay. Now if you want to validate it, you have to save your business rule first. So I'll save my business rule. Asia. So this is my business rule. I'll say okay. And now I'll say validate. Whenever I say validate, it will show where this particular business rule is. I'll say nothing. So validation is completed. No errors found. Fine. I'll close this business rule. Now I'll go back. I'll come to administrators and I'll go to my manage data forms. Because I want to attach that particular business rule with this particular web form. So I'll go to my web form, budget folder, and I'll select this and I'll say edit. If you want to attach your business rule, select your business rule tab, and in this, if you see, you'll be able to see all your business rules. So calculation scripts, they are given with a name called as calculation scripts, and business rules are given with a starting name called as rule. This is your business rule. So Asia currency is my business rule. I'll take it to my right hand side and I'll say save. So now my web form is attached with that business rule. Let me open my business. So if you see, you are able to see your Asia currency. Now if I run this, if I double click this, this particular rule is getting executed and it says it ran successfully. Now if I say refresh, you see your data is getting copied from here to account zero. But this particular business rule, Asia currency business rule, now this is running only for India. Okay? But what my requirement is, if it is an Indian user, he should be asked with a prompt saying that what entity you want to run. If he gives India, it has to run for India. If he gives US, it has to run for US. If he gives UK, it has to run for UK. If we use Canada, it has to run for Canada. This is my requirement. So for that, we have to go into your variables. So in my variable, there are two types of variables that I can define. One is local variable and the other one is global variable. Local variables are the variables which can be used within this business rule, whereas global variables are the variables which can be used with this this business rule, and it can be used with another business rule also. It can be used outside a business rule also. But where can I define my local variable? Local variable is defined in this particular business rule, and your global variables are defined under a tab called as global variables tab. Here you can define your global variables. But first, let us try to define your local variable first. So to have a local variable, I'll select local variable and I'll say add. And I'll give a name called as entity. Or I'll give a name called as EN, short name. Okay. After giving this, the type of variable that you are going to pass through this is a member name you are going to pass. So I'll select as member name. But from which dimension you are going to pass it? From your entity dimension you are going to pass it. Okay? And say if you want this particular business rule to run for a specific entities, every time this business rule should run for 5 entities, there is no change in it, then you can give those values, default values. You can find them and you can give all those 5 values. But I don't want this. What I want? Whichever entity I want, that particular entity, this particular business rule should run. Then instead of selecting saved selections, I'll be selecting something called as runtime prompts. Whenever the business rule is going to run, at that time prompt me for which entity you have to run this. So I'll say runtime prompt. After selecting this runtime prompt, I'll select them as default values. I'll select India, I select US, I'll select Canada, and I'll select UK. But I'm not selecting Europe. Means from this particular business rule, you can run only for this particular entities. You cannot run for Europe. I'm just limiting them. I'm limiting the selection. In case if I give default values, what it will do? It will run for all the entities. I don't want that. So for that, I have provided that in my limit. After that, I have to provide the prompt. What you are going to, how you want to be prompt. So enter. Enter your entity. I'll say apply. So save as EN. Okay. It got saved. Let me close. Now I'm able to see this particular. So how will I use this particular EN in this particular source? Instead of India, I'll give a name called as EN, but I'll be putting it in my square brackets. This is read as a runtime or local variable. It is nothing but read as a variable. If it is a substitution variable, what we will be putting? Ampersand name. Same as if it is a business rule local variable or global variable or runtime prompt, we will be providing this square brackets. Okay. Now what I'll do is I'll save this. I'll close this. The same business rule now I'm going to execute here. When I say Asia currency, what it is asking? It is asking enter your entity. So I'll say India. I'll say validate. It says all runtime prompts values are valid. And when I say launch, it starts running your business. So now with a single business rule, I can also run my US related information. How will I run it? When I say save, so this data got saved, and when I run this Asia currency, in this place I'll provide, instead of India, I'll provide US. When I say validate, it gets validated, and if I say launch, it gets launched. Now if I refresh my data, what happens? Yep, already. With a single business rule, with help of user inputs, I can run my business rule. Same way, in case if I am going to input on my Europe, so 100, I'll save this data, and when I launch this, so I can go to my selections and I can find it. If you see, I'm not able to see my Europe in this. Since I'm restricted not to run this particular business rule on Europe. This way, you can generate your local variables. The same way, now I'm going to write another business rule. In that business rule, if I want to use EN, I cannot use it because it is a local variable. So instead of that, I can create a global variable. It is also same. Right click on this and I'll say new variable. But difference is your global variable will have security. Okay. So for that you have to select your outline. This is the outline. And I'll give my variable name as EN. Say EN1. Because you have to have a differentiation between your EN. Say year I want to select. Say FY. Financial year. In this, I'll select it as a member. And I'll select for which dimension it has to be. For year member. And instead of default values, I have to make it as runtime prompt. And in this limit, I'll provide all these years. Say I want all these years. Till 60. Take this. Then say okay. Okay. And the prompt string. select year.
Year.
Okay. After doing this, usage you need not bother about, properties you not go in, but you have to go and provide access. Who all should have access? I'll say add. So admin and admin internal should have access on this. I'll say. Okay, when I save this, it is getting saved as FY. Where it is getting saved? It is getting saved under your global variables. But I have to use this particular global variable in my business called EN. Sorry, Asia currency, right? Where is this calculation stuff? This is my business. So in this, in place of my year, I have to use that year. F1. So to import that, let me go to variables, select your runtime prompts. Still I am able to see only EN. What you do? Add global variable. When you select this, it will display all your global variables. Out of this, which global variable I have to use? I have to use this F1. If I say OK, it gives display. But still I cannot use it because it is in hide mode. Uncheck this, then it is available. If it is checked, this particular variable will not be available. I'll uncheck this and I'll go to my source. In place of FY12, what I'll be putting? I'll be putting only FY. And I'll be putting in square brackets. Now I'll save this. When I say validate, it will also ask for my select your year, select your entity. And what type of thing you have to select? You cannot select dimension name, but you have to select a member name. So you can select your entity. See, your Europe is locked. And same way, if I want to select my years, I can select my other years are locked. So this way I can use my global variable. Now, if I run this same business rule, so it is also asking for my F1, validate and launch. This is how you can run your business rules, or this is how you can attach your. And from interview point of view, they'll be asking you a question saying that in how many ways I can launch my business rules. You can launch your business rules in two ways. One is you can launch it through web-based. Through web you can launch it. And the other one is you can launch it using command prompt. So sometimes they will be also asking, can I automate my business scripts? Calculation scripts you can automate using Maxwell scripts. So in the same way, can I automate my business scripts? Yes, you can automate your business scripts. And there is also something called as sequencing. Say I want to run set of business rules. One business rule after the other business rule. So for that, there is an option called as sequence. You see, you have a sequence. Right click on this and say new sequence. Okay, so to this particular sequence, if I say add, all my business rules will be available. What all business rules you want? First, which business rule do you want? Say, I want all this business. So while I am selecting some business rules. Okay, so now I want to move this particular business rule to be run first. Say, I'll say move. This will be moved. So this way you can sequence this. And if you want any variables, all these variables will also be available, and launch variables you can just input them. Type your variables and they will be launched automatically. So when you save this, it will ask for a name. Launch variable must be specified when heading this check. All these variables has to be specified. That is the error it is showing, because some variables we are not using. So all variables have to be inputted with data. Okay. So this way we can launch your business rules in a sequence. Okay. So after creating this, I can just export it. Export my business rule. So let us export this particular Asia currency. I'll say save as. No. Say automate launch variable. So enter your entity India and here is F511. So when I say automate, where you want to save this file? Say I want to save this on my computer E drive and then Asia. Let us think I have to put it into my Asia. So what is the file name that you want to give? So I want to give some name called as BHDR, and it will be stored with an extension called as XML. When I say save, this particular file is now getting saved into your E drive. So such a file I can automate. So this file I can automate. But to automate this, from where I can automate it? You have to automate it from C drive, go to Hyperion, and then just go to products, and then just go to SBase, Roslyn SBase client, I think. Yes. I'm checking where I will find this particular .cmd file. Okay. So in this particular path, I am able to see something called command line launcher. So this particular command line launcher can be used to automate your business rule. So now through command prompt, I want to launch this particular business rule. So then I can run it from here. So just have an idea, from here you can run it. So no need how you will run it, how you will write the code and all, it is not that much required. You will be using this command launcher, and with this you will be using your extracted file, automated file, which is placed in your E drive Asia folder. Using this two, you can automate your business. So how we'll automate, that is not that much. We'll be creating a batch file, mostly a batch file, which will automate your business. Not only calculation scripts, you can also automate your business. That is done through this particular option, right? Whenever user enters your data and if you go to your business rules and if I select my properties, so in this I want this to run whenever user enter data and save it. Now if user runs this business rule, your business rule will not run. But if we say save, automatically it will ask for your prompts before saving your data. So whenever you say save, what it does, what it will do, first it will save your data and automatically it will run your business based on the prompts that you put. That is, this is not the automation. They have to run on their own by nightly, mostly. Whenever business is not there, all your business should run one by one. So for that, how you can automate? You can automate with help of your command launcher. You can command line launcher. In two ways we can launch. One is web-based web line launcher and another one is command line launcher. This is web line launcher. From here also we can launch it. Business rules, you can go into this and you can select your specific calculation script and you can launch it. So from web forms you can launch it. From ES you can launch it. And the other one is from your command launcher also you can launch. So this completes your business. Yes, you can. That batch file, how you are scheduling? Help of schedulers. Using scheduler, you can launch it. So from, if it is from Windows, from where you will launch it? From system tools. In system tools, you have something called as schedule task. That particular batch file, you will be scheduled. At what time it has to run, that thing you can schedule using an external tool called as scheduler. No component has internally a scheduler in it. Okay? Okay, this is a scheduling task. Okay, after doing this, so almost your business rules is done. Business rules, components are done and everything is done. So next thing that we need to discuss is, so business rules are done. So from this, we have to talk about task list menus, user variables, and workflow, right? Okay, so what is this user variable? Now I'm having these many web forms with me. So when I go to my manage data forms, I'm able to see these many web forms. Actual web forms are there, budgeted web forms are there. Say for example, these particular web forms are now opening for year financial year 12. Now this particular web forms has to open for FY 13. Next year when I go, I have to open this particular web form for FY 13. So if I go to edit, if it is one web form, I'll go to my year and I'll change it to FY 13. Then if it is 100 web forms, if you are having 100 web forms, how you are going to change it? So you have to go to each and every web form, edit it, and change the year. Instead of doing that, what I'll do is, I'll go to administrator, and I'll say manage variables, and in this, I'll say add a user variable. For which dimension you want to create a variable? Right now, my requirement is for years, and I'll user variable name, say per year, is my user variable name, I'll say okay. Instead of putting my year in that particular web form, what I'll do is I'll go to data forms, I'll select this and I'll edit this. In this, I'll put, instead of selecting my year, what I'll do is I'll remove this and I'll select my current year and submit this and I'll save this web form. Same way, I'll open this particular web form. I think this is a composite web form. Only a symmetric and asymmetric. I'll go to point of view. Instead of FY year, FY 12, what I'll select? I'll select my current year. I'm just selecting my user variable. Okay. So for sample, I've done it for two web forms. Now if I run this particular web form, if a user tends to run this particular web form, it throws your user variable is not set. If I run this particular business rule, it shows before if you want to run this particular web form, set your user variable. So every user has to go and set his user variable. So where is that user variable set? Go to files. And in this, there is something called as preference. So when you select your preferences, this particular tab will open. In this, select your user variables. And in this, if you see, this particular thing is empty. Say, now I want to run this particular web form for FY 12. Okay, I'll save this. Now if I run this web form, this particular web form is now opening for year FY 12. And if I run this, this is also opening for year. Here FY 12. Now I want to open this particular both web forms for year FY 13. Before what you used to do, go to each and every web form and change that particular variable. Now what I'll do is, one activity, I'll go to preferences, I'll go to this, instead of 12, I'll make it as 13 and I'll save it. After saving this, I'll just run this particular. Now if you see, it is opening for year FY 13. The same web form, another web form is also opening for FY 13. So 100 web forms, if they are associated with this particular user variable, they will be opening for FY 13. Means you are reducing your human activity and also you are reducing your human errors. Say for example, if I forgot to change my year in two or three web forms, in that case, this will lead to an issue. Instead of that, this is an easy method. Create your user variable and use it. Mostly for which purpose will you be using your user variables? Means you will be using it for your current year, current month and current plan sessions, current plan scenario. For these three reasons, you will be using your user variables. Okay, year, month, scenarios. These all are stored into your RDBMS, relational database. S-based substitution variables can be used with this, but server level, where are your substitution variables stored in your SBase server? It is stored into .acc. Your substitution variables are stored into Yes, yes, yes. Right? That we have seen, right? Okay. Your user variables are stored into RDBMS and your substitution variables are stored into .sec file. They are available on your server level. So this is about your user variables. And now, as an administrator, I want to assign some tasks to users. Okay, so for that I'm going to create some tasks and say manage tasks. So this task is also something like your web forms means appearance. So I can create my folders. So I'll say create. So on this create, I'm going to give some name called as actual task. All these tasks, all this folder will have is, it will be having actual related tasks. So I'll click on this and I'll say create. When I say create, it will ask for a name. So I'll give some name as ACT for workflow. I'll edit this. Now I'll be able to see this particular type of work. I can create tasks in this. First I'll say add chain. What type of tasks I can create? Your task can be a descriptive, means your task can give some information to user what activity he has to perform, or it can be a URL. Whenever he clicks on this task, he may be logged into some other planning application, or it can be a data form related activity, or it can be a business rule activity, or it could be a workflow related activity. So a task can be of five types. It can be a URL based, it can be a data form, it can be a task something on your business rule, or it can be a task something on your workflow, or it can be a task something on some description. So when I say description, I'm giving some name called as instruction. All this task is nothing but some instructions that it is going to give. So first task I'm going to define is input data into web form. Okay. Second task, run business rule. Third task, log into Gmail and send a file to some specific user. This is also one task that you are giving to your lower level users. And the fourth option, approve workflow. So five tasks we have defined. Still what we have data form we have done, URL we have done, business rule we have done, workflow we have done, descriptive we are doing. So all five tasks, four tasks I have defined in this particular descriptive. All these are things, what this is doing, input data into webform, but into which webform you have to use, that information we don't have. Which business rule I have to run, where is the URL that I have to log in. I know Gmail, it is www.gmail.com, but where I have to log into this, and for which workflow I have to approve, all these related informations you can set in your successive tasks. Right now I am defining only descriptive tasks, means user will be reading all these instructions. Okay, what is the due date for this? Say due date is today. Mostly my due date is today. When should I get alerts? Let us make it as 8th is my due date, tomorrow is my due date, and I want alerts to be displayed from 7th onwards. So When I should get this particular alert? Every 1 hour I should get. Seeing that, complete this task, complete this task. I should be getting this alert. So I'll say save. So this task got defined. Now under this task, I'm going to define subtasks. So I'll select this and I'll say add change. The same way, now I'm not going to give a descriptive, but I'm selecting a web form because my first task is input data into your data form. Already you have your data forms. Okay. So what is the due date for this? It is 8th is your due date because you have this given this in your description. An alert should start from 7 and every 1 hour it should start alerting you. But which web form you want to run, that you will be setting in your properties. You have your forms folder in this. Because this is for actuals, I'll select actuals for FY. All these web forms are available. I want to input into this particular actuals for FY. I'll say okay. I'll select this now. I'll uncheck this and I'll say add save. I have inputted my data. Next, what I need to do? I need to run my business. So if I want to run my business rule, so due date is 8th, 8th is your last date and alerts should start from 7th onwards. But which business rule you have to run after completing this? I want to run this particular business rule called Asia currency. This is the business rule that I have to run and save. Okay. After this, now I want a URL to be inputted. So I'll give URL. Gmail. Due date is your 8th and alerts should start from 7th and every 1 hour it has to prompt me. And I'll go into my properties and I'll give my URL www.gmail.com. I think this will work. And I'll say save. Same way, still we didn't define any workflow, but still, if I select workflow, we come to know what this workflow is. Due date is 8 and alert is every 1 hour. And I go into my properties, it will display where which particular workflow you have to approve. Right now we don't have any workflow initiated, but still let me save. So I have all this task set. If you want, you can also set another task. Not only this task, you can define other subtasks or main task and subtask. But let me save this. I have saved this. Now, what I'll do is, as a user, end user, I'll ask users to log into basic mode. Whenever user is logging in basic mode, he'll be able to see what all tasks are given to him. Tasks are again assigned with help of security. So I can define who all users will be performing this particular task. When I select this folder, you are getting assigned tasks. I can select this and I can assign who all users should be displayed with this particular task list. So task list will be displayed only when you are, means freely they will be readily available when you are in basic mode. If you are in advanced mode also, you can go into this task list and then you can open this. But always I prefer to select your basic mode. When you select your basic mode, now I am able to see my instructions. So this is descriptive. What it said? Input data into web forms, run business rules, log into Gmail. All instruction user is getting. Now what he has to do? He will expand this and select this. So he'll go into this and he'll input his data. Right now my user variable is set to FY13. Let me set it to FY12. I'll say save. Now I'll go to this input data form. Automatically it is open. I need not go into my folders and search for which webform I have to use. So I write a mail and say, input data into this particular web form. User has to go into the folders and he has to search for that particular web form. If I'm having 1,000 web forms, he has to search in that particular thing. Instead of that, if I provide this type of instructions, even user is feeling friendly, right? So he can easily go input this numbers and save this. After saving this, he'll say just complete. Whatever he's asked to do, he's done with it. He'll say completed, and now you are able to see a tick mark. This main task will be completed only when you complete all subtasks. You cannot directly click on this task and say complete because this is blurred out. Now I'll go to my business rules. When I select this particular business rule, I'm able to see this particular business rule. When I say launch, it'll ask my substitution variable and say launch. Your rule is completed and say complete. But manually you have to select whether it is completed or not. So this task got completed. When I say log into Gmail, now my laptop is not connected to URL. When I say log into URL, it will open your web page. You can complete it and you can say completed. Now approve your workflow. So now you can just say approve your workflow. Right now you don't have access because nothing is initiated. You cannot approve it. When we come to this particular workflow, we'll understand. Right now, I'll say this is also completed without doing anything. Even users can do this also. Without doing anything, we can say complete. Okay? So this way you can use your passwords. Now, as an administrator, I'll come back. I'll go to advanced mode. Okay? And I'll go to my view task list and I'll check how many I have provided my tasks, whether it is completed or not. I can go to my status. So this is my task list. I can see the instructions. So these are the instructions that I have provided. So these are the instructions. No instruction that I have provided in this. So nothing but input data. So I can go to my status. And I can check 100% complete. So with this I can assign to end users what to be done. Without, means why they have given this option means, say if a user is not having planning related knowledge, where to select forms, where to run business rules, only small thing that I can give him, I can ask him to go to edit or view, go to view and select basic mode. After selecting basic mode, once he sets this basic mode, lifelong it will be in basic mode only, and he can go into that particular task and he can search. He can directly click on that particular task, input wherever you want and run that. Small instructions, instead of giving complete planning related information, I can just help him with this particular task. So clear about task list. This is how you can use your task list with your planning application. Task list is the menus is also one such thing only. Say if I am in this particular web form. I am in this web form. When I right click on this, right now I am getting this type of option. Instead of that, I should get an option where this type of option I will be getting. In this, I have to get a menu. I should get just like your refresh. I should get an option where I have to select my next web. Again, your menu can be of 5 types. It can be a main heading. Means this is a main heading. Under this main heading, you can have a subheading. So main heading, under main heading, is one option that you can select with your menu. And the other one is you can select business rule. You can select web form. You can apply workflow, or you can have a UR. All four things, whatever you are having in your task list, the same things can be applied in your menus. So mostly we'll see tomorrow how to use this menus. So if we are done with menus, last thing that is left is workflow, and after workflow we'll be looking into financial reports and we will also be looking into your web analysis. Mostly tomorrow we'll complete it. Workflow, menu, and web analysis effort. Hopefully tomorrow we will be completing your entire planning. So we will stop for today. Clear? Any doubts in this? No. Automation is different and this is different. In your webcom, if it is already running, then there is no need of defining that particular task. Then there is no need of defining that. There is no need to set it in your task. If I am attaching it, if some business rule is not attached to it, in that case, means we are seeing for possibilities. So, full stop. So this is the core concept of your planning. There is nothing other than this. And mostly, from planning point of view, they'll be asking only till your webcoms and business rules, task list, menus, user variables. Very rarely they'll be touching. But still, we are discussing each other. So, let me stop it.